colorível. Colorável?
Colorável.
Sim. Colorável.
Okay.
Okay, the clue was choose randomly. So Paul already did the lower bound with you, right? So the lower bound is easier. So let's do it again just to warm up. So the first thing is, what does this mean? This means that the minimum is at least this. That means that for every hypergraph, k uniform, with fewer than 2 to the k minus 1 edges, there exists a coloring of the vertices with 2 colors such that does not exist a monochromatic edge. Right? Okay. This is just rewriting the definition. So, I want to try and persuade you that you should have been able to do this question. Okay? No? Eu tô tentando dizer, ou te convencer, que você deve conseguir resolver esse problema. Ou pelo menos essa parte. O que eu fiz, nada mais do que reescrever a afirmação. A afirmação que m de k maior ou igual a 2 elevado a k menos 1 é nada mais do que para todo hipergrafo existe uma coloração. E a dica é choose randomly. Então, o que você vai escolher aleatoriamente? Yeah, right? You're given a hypergraph. You have to show there exists a coloring. Choose randomly. Okay. Yeah. Ah, tá. Pode ser. Faz sentido. Tá. Ok? Que mais você pode fazer do que escolher as cores aleatoriamente? E não sabe nada sobre hipergrafo, então por que não escolhe aleatoriamente com propriedade de meia? E todas independentemente. E o que a gente sempre faz, sempre define variável aleatório x, que é igual ao número de adesivos monocromáticos a gente calcula a esperança que é soma sobre arestas da probabilidade que aresta é monocromático que é igual a de H vezes 2 elevado a menos K mais 1 por ser azul ou vermelho que é menor do que 1. Probabilidade que x maior ou igual a 1, menor ou igual esperante X, pelo Markov, que é menor do que 1. Então, com probabilidade positivo, X igual a 0. Que é a mesma coisa do que existe em relação tal que x igual a 0, que é exatamente o que a gente quer. Não existe esse monocromático, mas depois de x igual a 0. Eu botei esse problema no exame porque essa é uma das técnicas que eu mais estou querendo que você que entre nas suas cabeças. E se essa técnica, se você realmente entende essa técnica, você só tem que seguir. Você quase não tem que pensar. Você só escreve o que você quer provar. Ok, uma ideia que está aqui. E depois sempre faz a mesma coisa. Isso é o resultado. Tá? Então você não deve ter medo no início do problema que você não sabe o que você deve fazer. Só segue os passos e muitas vezes funciona. Ok. Parte B é um pouco mais difícil. Qual é a afirmação? A afirmação é M de K é O grande de K quadrado 2 elevado a K. É a mesma coisa de quê? Sim, mas... Pela definição, que é um outro jeito de escrever essa afirmação. Que vem para todo hipergrafo, existe uma correlação, tal que blá. Nesse caso... correlação de quê? De quê? Vezes de quê? Qual? Como? Obrigado. Existe um hipergrafo K uniforme com esse número de arestas. Tá ok. Para toda a coloração das vértices desse hipergrafo. É isso. Existe uma aresta monocromática. Ok. Então, tem que mostrar que existe alguma coisa. Como a gente vai achar esse objeto?
Calcula a probabilidade de contar igual a zero.
Como? Ainda não temos um espaço de probabilidade.
Como definir o espaço de probabilidade?
Vamos definir, ok? Que vai ser nosso espaço de probabilidade?
Uma coisa, colorir aleatoriamente também.
Qual é o hipergrafo? Tem que mostrar que existe um hipergrafo. Pega qual?
Pega a raiz disso aí, vértices.
Vai ser um grafo completo? Hipergrafo completo. Se pegar um gráfico completo, o que vai acontecer? Quantos vértices vai ter esse cara? Quantos vértices?
K sobre 2.
Esse é um hipergrafo K uniforme. Bem menos vértices. Até mais ou menos, menos que 2K. Não tem problema. Se um grafo... Suponha que tem 2K menos 2 vértices. E o grafo completo. Hipergrafo completo. Tem quantas arestas? Escolhe cá. Isso é mais ou menos o quê? Dois elevado a... Então... Esse cara aqui, quase a mesma coisa, é mais ou menos 2 elevado a 2k menos 2. Tá? Mais ou menos 4 elevado a k, que é muito maior do que esse número. Tá? E esse cara marca quase a mesma coisa. Não é? Esse é o... De verdade, é mais ou menos esse cara sobre o raiz quadrada de k. Porque é isso? Porque é, mas, ok. Soma n escolhe k, k igual a 0 até n, igual a 2 elevado a n. E o cara k igual a n sobre 2 é o maior cara, então... Então, essa não é uma prova, mas é um fato. Que 2 elevado a k em cima, não embaixo. Sabiam disso? Tá. Acreditam nisso? Ou não? Até um polinomial. Isso é mais ou menos 4 elevado a k, que é muito maior do que k quadrado 2 elevado a k. E esse cara, claro... Obviamente é 2 colorável. Ok? Porque esse hipergrafo completo com 2k menos 2 vértices é, obviamente, 2 colorável. Pega k menos 1 vértices de cada cor. E, obviamente, não tem uma aresta de k vértices da mesma cor.
K menos 1 vértices, com 0 ao resto.
Tá não?
Não.
Só? Não mesmo? Ok. Ok? Ok? Ok, então, hipergrafo completo não funciona. O que a gente pode fazer? Como a gente vai provar que existe um hipergrafo com a seguinte propriedade?
Na verdade, eu não sei se
Não, as duas importam, mas o problema é qual o mínimo sobre todos os hipergrafos com qualquer número de vértices da número de arestas. Então, se você fixa o número de vértices, você vai ter uma outra função. Você está dizendo que o mínimo sobre... Ok, se... Seja M, NK, o mínimo número de arestas de H, tal que número de vértices de H é igual a N, número de arestas de H é K uniforme, e não 2 colorável. M de K igual ao mínimo sobre N de Mn de K. Tá, mas esse argumento foi para qualquer hipergrafo, vamos achar uma coloração. A gente tem que provar que existe um hipergrafo K uniforme.
Então, só pega um coin vértice, depois ele escolhe qual é N. Você calcula o valor esperado.
Você vai tentando provar para qualquer H com esse número de vértices, de arestas? Porque não vai dar. A gente mostrou um hipergrafo com esse número de arestas que não funciona.
Pega N vértices. Só que você não sabe qual é N, a gente vai ver qual é N de quadro no final.
Ok. Então, você está tentando provar que para qualquer H, com N vértices, isso funciona. Ok. Qual hipergrafo você quer colorir? Existe um hipergrafo.
Existe.
Para a cota inferior, temos que provar que para qualquer hipergrafo com esse número de arestas, existe uma coloração. Para a cota superior, a gente tem que provar que existe um hipergrafo, talvez com muitas vértices, não sei, com esse número de arestas, tal que para toda coloração existe um hipergrafo monocromático. Só olha a definição. Como?
Ué, prova que existe um hipergrafo, tal que para toda coloração existe uma aresta
monocromática. Isso. Então, parece que esse hipergrafo, a gente não sabe construir esse hipergrafo.
Acho que eu não entendi.
Mas qual foi a dica? A dica foi by choosing randomly. Então, como você quer escolher esse hipergrafo?
Aleatoriamente.
Né? Tá? Essa foi a dica. Se tiver uma dica... Vale a pena prestar atenção. Tá. Vamos escolher.
H aleatoriamente.
Ok, mas como? Essa parte é um pouco mais difícil. Como escolher, ok. Agora vamos fixar um n, que a gente não sabe o que é. Seja n igual a um de vértices de h. Vamos escolher as arestas com propriedade que a gente precisa para testar de arestas. E p elevado a k vezes n escolhe k mais ou menos k quadrado 2 elevado a k. Não está ali. Não está ali igual, não sei. Não, desculpa. Estou falando merda. A gente está escolhendo arestas com essa propriedade. Arestas. Mas não, cada vértice vai ser parte de muitas arestas. Então, pega cada aresta com a propriedade de P. Então, o número de arestas, seu hipergrafo aleatório vai ser mais ou menos k quadrado 2 elevado a k, com alta probabilidade. Tá? E vamos escolher a n depois. Tá? Ainda não sabemos se é a n certo. Ok. E H igual HNP, o hipergrafo aleatório de Erich Hänni. Então, cada aresta pertence a esse hipergrafo com probabilidade de P, independentemente. Ok. Então, o que é uma coloração? É nada mais que uma bipartição das vértices. E se a gente não escolheu as arestas ainda, cada bipartição são todas mais ou menos equivalentes. Porque a única coisa que importa é o quê? Tem A e B. Importa o tamanho de A e o tamanho de B. Então, o tamanho de A pode ser M e N menos M. E M provavelmente vai ser mais ou menos N sobre 2, mas ainda não sabemos. Ok. Switch back. So, we're doing problem 3 from the exam. So what's happened? We're trying to prove this, and I've just restated the problem in words. So we have to show there exists a K-uniform hypergraph with this many edges, such that for every coloring, there exists a monochromatic edge. Okay, and the only thing we decided so far is to follow the hint and to choose H randomly. Okay. So for the lower bound, we chose the coloring randomly. For the upper bound, we're going to choose the hypergraph randomly. Okay. So both bounds follow from choosing things randomly, but choosing different things. Okay. Okay. So what are we going to do? We're going to pick N to be the number of vertices. We don't know what n is yet. We'll choose it later. And we're going to pick edges independently at random with probability p, so that the total number of edges is roughly what we want it to be. So p times n choose k should be k squared n to the k, more or less. But it's not really going to matter exactly what we choose. Maybe I'll change this later very slightly. Okay. Okay. So what's the probability that there exists a coloring with no monochromatic edge? That's what we want to show. We want to show that with positive probability, there does not exist a coloring with no monochromatic edge. Right? That does not exist. Yeah. It's positive. Yeah. So we just needed to show the other one was less than one. Because in this case, there exists a hypergraph with this property. Okay. If the probability there does not exist a bad coloring is positive, then there exists a hypergraph such that this is. What am I saying? This is true, which means for every coloring that does not exist, a monochromatic edge. Is it okay? It's okay? No? Okay. Okay. Se a probabilidade que não existe uma coloração tal que não existe uma essa monochromática positiva, isso implica que existe hipergrafo, tá? Probabilidade positivo, esse é objeto aleatório, então existe objeto, tal que a afirmação vale, tal que não existe uma coloração VXH a 0,1, tal que não existe uma aresta monocromática. Sim? Não existe. Ok? Se a probabilidade de X de qualquer evento positivo, então existe uma H tal que acontece. Tá? Tal que o evento acontece. Tá. Isso é uma implicação. Se essa probabilidade é positiva, então existe uma H tal que acontece. Não? Se a probabilidade de evento A de variável aleatório X. Ok, evento. Não é nada mais que isso. Se a probabilidade de evento é positivo, o evento pode acontecer. Tá? Se o evento depende de hipergrafo H, então existe H tal que A acontece. Sim? Nada mais. Probabilidade de esse evento é positivo implica que existe uma H tal que esse evento acontece. Nada. Ok. Ok? Everyone happy? Good. Ok. This is just exactly the same thing as there exists a hypergraph such that for every coloring There exists a monochromatic edge, which is what we want. Right? This is just exactly this. Okay? Okay. So we want to prove this. Okay? Okay. How do we prove that the probability of something is positive? Well, how do we prove anything about random properties? What's the first thing we do? Very good. X is the number of what? At the moment, first thing we're doing is trying to show there does not exist a color ring. So the thing we should count is color rings, exactly. Number of color rings such that there does not exist a monochromatic edge. Okay. So this is the probability that X is zero. Okay? That's the same probability. We want to show it's positive, so we'd like to show, okay, it's not equal anymore, probability that X is at least one, which is at most the expected value of X, is less than one. It's enough to show that the expected number of colorings is less than one. Okay. So in this, so this statement would imply this one. No? It's okay? Same? Okay. So, all we have to do is calculate the expected number of color rings. What is the expected number of color rings? Well, it's always a sum, right? Sum over the number of color rings, so sum over it should be the sum over color rings, so we're counting the color rings with a certain property. The expected number is the sum over color rings of the probability that the coloring has that property. Right? It's okay? We're always doing the same thing. Every time. Right? We define a random variable that counts something to calculate the expected value. If it's the number of somethings with a certain property, you could do the sum over that thing, the probability of that property. Right? Vamos somar sobre todas as colorações da probabilidade que eles têm essa probabilidade. Então, o que é uma coloração? Uma coloração é nada mais do que uma função que mapa os vértices de H, que é 1 até N, a 0, 1. Que é nada mais do que uma partição das vértices. Soma sobre partições dos vértices da probabilidade que nenhuma aresta é monocromática. Quer dizer, não existe uma aresta dentro de zero nem dentro de um. Então, qual é essa propriedade? What's the probability that there's no monochromatic edge in this coloring? You're given a coloring, here it is, and then you choose your graph, your random hypergraph. Okay? Given a coloring, what's the probability that there's no monochromatic edge? Ginovo? Por que K4? Esse é o número de arestas.
A gente não está considerando a probabilidade de um aresta.
Então.
Essa probabilidade de
temos um bipartição das vértices. Né? Dado C. C é dado. C é uma partição das vértices. 0, 1. Tá? Agora a gente vai escolher o grafo aleatório H. O hipergrafo aleatório. Cada aresta presente com probabilidade P. Qual é a probabilidade que você não escolhe nenhuma aresta dentro de uma parte? Então, para cada aresta, cada conjunto de K elementos dentro de uma classe, você tem que não escolher essa aresta. So, we have to not choose every set of K vertices inside a part. Every vertex should be the same color. The two colors are 0 and 1, or red and blue. And if an edge is entirely inside one class, it's monochromatic. I didn't define it, and you didn't ask. Okay?
What's the size of the...
The size of what? The edge?
Yeah.
This has k elements. Every edge has k elements because our hypergraph is k uniform. It's the definition of k uniform. Okay? So every set of k vertices inside one of the classes must not be chosen. It's not chosen with probability 1 minus p. No.
No.
Cada aresta você escolhe a probabilidade de P.
Cada aresta.
Cada família de K vértices. Escolhe a probabilidade de P. Então, 1 menos P elevado o número de K conjuntos aqui, mais o número de K conjuntos aqui. Que é o quê? Que é M escolhe K, mais N menos M escolhe K, onde M é o tamanho desse conjunto aqui. Ok? Does it make sense? No. So we're given our universe has n elements. We're given a coloring of our n elements, which is just a bipartition. We're going to put m elements red and the rest blue. M, n minus n. Okay? We're given that. That's C. We want the probability that we didn't choose any of the edges inside the left or inside the right. How many edges are there? They're edges of size k, remember? Well, just m choose k here, and n minus m choose k here. That's the number of edges. And we must not choose any of them. And each one is chosen independently with probability p. Come on. Okay, so this is our random hypergraph. Every edge is in it with probability p. This is for every e that's a subset of the vertices of size k. Okay? Every set of k vertices is chosen with probability p, all independently. How many edges do we have here? The number here is m choose k. There's m choose k such edges e. And here, n minus m choose k. Right? Each of these edges is chosen independently at random. Cada dessas escadas tem probabilidade p de ser membro do grafo, hipergrafo. Então, probabilidade que todas independentemente. Então, a probabilidade de que nenhum deles está escolhido é 1 menos p elevado ao número deles. O número deles é m escolhe k mais n menos m escolhe k. Né? Tudo ok? Tudo ok? Não. Fala. De não escolher uma aresta, um dado aresta. Você não escolhe com probabilidade de 1 menos p, e você tem que não escolher que nenhuma delas. Tá? Okay. Ok. What is this thing at most? Well, an upper bound on this. Exactly. This is minimum. So by, if you like, convexity of n choose k, or convexity of x to the k. Convexidade de x elevado k. This is at most 1 minus p to the power n over 2 choose k plus n over 2 choose k. The way to minimize the number of edges that you have to avoid is to choose the two colors equally many times. Okay? Okay. So now we have a bound. On the expected value, it's what? It's.
So, desculpa. N squared is. No, N squared is equal to. Mais do que N squared.
m escolhe k mais n menos m escolhe k é maior ou igual 2 vezes n sobre 2 escolhe k. Tá. Então, 1 menos p elevado, isso é menor ou igual. Sim? Tudo ok? So, how many colorings do we have? Ooh. 2 to the power n. What's the probability of each one? 1 minus p to the power 2, n over 2 choose k. When is this less than 1? Okay, so now we do our usual trick. Exactly. 2 to the n, e to the minus 2p. I guess we want a lower bound on n over 2 choose k. So that's n over minus, thank you, to the k. Okay, so maybe I'll cheat very slightly here and put this instead. Without cheating too much. Maybe that's cheating too much. Okay. I won't cheat there. I'll do something slightly different here. E to the minus. So we want to compare n over 2 choose k with n choose k. Right. So I guess I'm going to claim something here. Sorry? No, I think I'm cheating too much, though. I think I have to be more careful. Yeah. No, I think just in this calculation here. So I want to say that n over 2 choose k is roughly equal to 2 to the minus k n choose k. Okay? So this is a fact that you can check, I guess. Okay? This is if k is fixed and n is big. It follows easily from the definition, or from the formula. Okay? Okay. So then what do we have? E to the minus p, 2 to the minus k plus 1, n choose k. Now we can throw this in, and we get... what? Here we get a k squared, right? Basically e to the minus k squared. Which is less than 1. So why did I need the k squared? Sorry. It does matter. We haven't chosen n yet. Thank you. Sorry. We get a 2 to the power n times basically e to the minus k squared. We want this to be less than 1, so what should we choose n to be? K squared. We had to choose n. So what's the point? Why can't we just choose n smaller and choose a smaller value of a smaller value than k squared, because we need to do this approximation. This stops being true if n is smaller than k squared. So I guess this part I didn't really expect you to do. I was just hoping that you'd get sort of some way through this. You know, decide to choose your hypergraph randomly, write down something like this, and maybe get as far as this. Okay, and bluff the last bit. But so this is what's really happening is when n gets smaller than k squared, then this approximation breaks down, and so this inequality here is no longer true. As I should say, I don't know. I'm on a thesis defense on Monday, so I might have to spend the weekend reading someone's thesis. So maybe not this weekend. So I was away this last weekend. So hopefully I'll give it back to you on Wednesday. I wasn't expecting you to do the entire thing. I mean. This is one of the things that you have to learn, right? That you pick a problem and you do it. And when you're a research mathematician, you have a lot of possibilities, but you have to pick one thing and focus on it. So it's part of the skill. The most difficult parts were this, and I thought the lower bound on one part B, which I gave a hint for as well. But I don't know. And I guess on two you had to remember something from class, but anyway. I guess we should do another exam. You want one next week already, or the week after that? So votes for next exam, which I'll try to make easier. The dates. Either next week or the week after. Yeah, so I mean, I guess I mean Wednesday, yeah. Next week. Well, I mean, if they're not here, they don't get to vote, right? Do you think they're coming back, or they've been scared off by the exam?
Probably one or two. The one with the hair in the group, and the one.
Yeah, there's only seven in total. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think.
Three.
Yeah.
Are we
having yeah, so if you all vote the same way, then it doesn't matter. But, okay, votes.
Next week means next Wednesday.
Sure. I mean, you can choose. We can have a vote for. If you like. Go on.
week after.
Yeah, meaning not next week, the week after that. Monday or Wednesday.
Yeah.
I'll vote on the Monday of the week after.
Okay.
Okay, Monday of the week after.
Okay, Monday week after wins. Okay. So you can tell the others. Any requests for what should be on it? Which bit is more easy? I don't know. For what should be on the test?
more time?
More time? No, it's impossible.
Less questions.
Oh. there are only three. Okay. The trouble with putting fewer questions is that then if you can't do the question, you're dead.
I was confused to what to do. I thought he was expecting us to do two questions, as you said, at the moment of the test. So I remember 70 to 10. I don't know what to do.
Right, but you have to start somewhere.
Yeah.
But so I think I still didn't really understand what the problem was. Would say, I mean, you start at question one. And it's a Ramsey number. And what else are you going to do with a Ramsey number? Sorry?
Planar graphs.
Planar graphs. Okay. Right. But it has a lot of computation. I was trying to give things with very little computation so that you could just write, you know, two lines and it's obvious you have the right idea. I mean, what would the ideal solution to question one look like? That's the lower bound. Yeah, they're the... That's it. And Edir Sekeresh. Okay. Question 1A done. Right. Okay, I'll see what I can find. Okay, so we have half an hour. I was going to start telling you about the regularity lemma, but it would be good if everyone is here. So maybe I give you a 20-minute, very rough introduction to the regularity lemma, and then on Monday I'll start doing it properly. Okay. So none of you have seen this before, right? Okay, so the regularity lemma is a very powerful tool in graph theory that essentially says the following. So if you're given an arbitrary graph, it's very difficult to say anything about it. So take a simple example. If you don't know anything about a graph, then you need to have more than n squared over four edges to show that you contain a triangle. If G is a random graph, then you need many fewer edges. You only need to have a lot more than n edges and you're already likely to have a triangle. So random graphs are much easier to deal with than arbitrary graphs. And what the regularity lemma says is basically that every graph is made up of a bounded number of random graphs. Almost. Okay. So what does it tell you? It tells you every vertex with n vertices is made of a bounded number of random graphs. And I cheated slightly, because really I should add in the word quasi. Too much what? Ah, too vague. Okay. So let me make it slightly more concrete. Let's take a graph G. And with the regularity lemma, we should always assume that G has a decent number of edges. So at least some constant n squared. So for some small constant, constant n squared edges. If G has fewer edges than this, then there are sparse versions of regularity, but it's more complicated. So let's simplify our lives by assuming we're reasonably dense. Okay. So what can you do? The regularity lemma gives you a partition of the vertices into a bounded number of parts. V1, V2, to Vk. K is big O1. So this shouldn't quite make sense yet, but I'll tell you in a second what it means. Such that if you look at the bipartite graph between almost any pair, it's quasi-random. So what do I mean by quasi-random? Well, I have to make that precise. But if you look at say almost all of the pairs Vi, Vj, are quasi-random. So there's a parameter epsilon that determines what I mean when I say almost. Okay. So we're going to have a parameter epsilon that's going to be positive and very small. And k is going to be bounded. Okay, so I'm about to define it. That's the more technical part. So I'm trying to go build up slowly. You should think it shares a lot of properties with a random graph. Okay? So there are various notions of what it means to be quasi-random. So I'm just going to tell you the one which works with the regularity lemma. Okay. So almost all means 1 minus epsilon times k choose 2. Okay? So almost all pairs means 1 minus epsilon times k choose 2 pairs have this property. Okay? So that part's easy. And the number of parts is going to depend on epsilon, but not on n. Okay? This is crucial. So the smaller epsilon is, and epsilon is also going to be in here. The smaller epsilon is, the more random-like the pairs look, but the more of them there are. Okay? Okay, so what do I mean by quasi-aleatorio? The definition of an epsilon regular pair. This means quasi-random. So a pair of vertex sets, so for example, A and B in a graph, are called epsilon regular, which you think epsilon quasi-random, if the following holds. If for every subset X of A and a subset Y of B, let me put them here. A, B. So we want them to share properties with a random graph. So one property of a random graph is if you take a subset of the vertices on the left and a subset of the vertices on the right that's reasonably large, say x is at least epsilon proportion of A and y is at least epsilon proportion of B, then the number of edges between x and y should be roughly the density times size of x times size of y. Right? If it were completely random, then you would expect the number of edges between x and y to be roughly what it should be. And that's what the property is. So it says that the number of edges between x and y divided by x times y minus the number of edges between a times a and b divided by a times b in absolute value is small. Okay. So this is certainly a property that a random graph would have. with high probability. Okay. And it seems actually fairly weak. Right? All you want is that between big sets, the number of edges is roughly what it's supposed to be. So now I can replace quasi-random with epsilon regular. Regularities. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Is this? So. Okay. There's a few of them which are not epsilon regular, but the rest are. Yes. Yeah, so the regularity lemma, you don't really understand it by staring at the statement and trying to put it in place. You understand it by applying it. So I'll show you various applications, and after you've applied it a few times, it starts to make sense. But the first time you see it, and I haven't even written the full statement yet, it looks very weird. But now I have basically a statement, right? Perhaps I'll. Sorry? No. It's there. So. It's the lemma. For every epsilon, there exists a large constant k such that for every graph g, there exists a partition of the vertex set into k parts for some k, at most k0. Such that the following holds. So I didn't tell you all the vertex sets have the same size, plus or minus one, because you know it might not even be divisible by k. Let's not worry about divisibility. So all the vertex sets have almost the same size. And the most epsilon k squared pairs VIVJ are not epsilon regular. Okay. And that's all. So there exists this so-called semi-ready partition of the vertex set such that almost all the pairs are epsilon regular. Okay. So why is this useful at all? Well, it's useful because of the following embedding lemma. So let's take three sets and suppose that we have that every pair is epsilon regular. I want to find a triangle in this graph. Can I do it? So this is G. And the question is, is there a triangle in G? So if we don't know anything, we need at least half the edges to guarantee having a triangle. If we're completely random, we need only 1 over n proportion. If you're epsilon regular, then you need something in between. You need density delta. So what I mean is, this guy is at least delta. And delta should be quite a lot bigger than epsilon. But it's still going to be small. Okay. So if you have positive density and you're sufficiently regular, you can find a triangle. In fact, not just one triangle, you can find order n cubed triangles. If each of these sets have size n, you can find roughly n cubed. Okay. So this is the power of regularity, that you can find. Yeah, so delta cubed n cubed, actually. So the number of triangles G is at least, say, delta minus epsilon cubed times n cubed. So. And actually, this is very easy to prove. So, shall I try and prove it in 3 minutes? Okay. So, first we need a simpler fact that I'll try and prove here. Suppose you have an epsilon regular pair. I claim that very few of the vertices have the wrong degree. Okay. So let's put this guy equal to P. So P is the density of the pair. And let's look at all of those vertices whose degree across is less than 1 minus epsilon times P times B. Okay? That's smaller than it's supposed to be. I claim there's at most epsilon times A of these. Why does that follow immediately from the definition? Because if there were more than epsilon times A of them, we could set this guy here to be X, the whole of the right-hand side to be Y, and we'd have contradict this assumption. Okay. This is equal to P, and this is at most 1 minus epsilon times P. Oh, sorry. I guess I mean P minus epsilon. Okay. So there are only epsilon proportion of them with low degree. Okay, now let's go. Look between A and B. Throw away epsilon times A things which have low degree to B. Absolutely. They all have actually the correct degree, but I'll only need this bound. Okay. So we throw away the vertices who don't have good enough degree to B, and we throw away the vertices that don't have good enough degree to C. And now any other vertex has high degree here and high degree here, meaning at least delta minus epsilon times n. And delta minus epsilon times n. Okay. I threw away all the vertices with low degree to B. It would be delta times, it's delta times n on average, but I lost a little bit in this argument. Right? So this p is now at least delta.
Okay, delta is then p.
So this p is at least delta. Okay. That's our lower bound. So the density across is at least delta. Okay? So every vertex not in this set has high degree into B. High meaning delta minus epsilon times n. Is that okay? Because I threw away the ones with smaller degree. And the same thing on the right-hand side. I threw away the vertices which don't have this many neighbors in C. So every other vertex has high degree to the left and to the right. Okay? We're almost done. This set can now be our x, and this set is our y. X has size at least delta minus epsilon proportion, that's bigger than epsilon, and y has size delta minus epsilon, that's bigger than epsilon. So between x and y, we know how many edges there are. There are at least delta minus epsilon times p times n squared. Okay. We could do this. We did this for every vertex v that's not in one of these rubbish sets. So we gain an extra, okay, delta minus 2 epsilon. Oh, whatever. Right? Sorry. Delta minus n squared times n squared. Is that what I mean? No, times delta. Times delta minus epsilon. Sorry. Anyway, the point is there's at least one edge between x and y. And now you have a triangle. And in fact, you have many edges by the same argument. And you had many choices for V, so you have lots and lots of triangles. Okay, it's not very easy, but it's quite easy. And in fact, the same thing works not just for triangles, but for any graph you like. Okay. And I'll maybe try and prove that next time or the time after. Okay? So you can apply the regularity lemma if you find enough dense-ish regular pairs, and almost all of them are regular. So if you find enough pairs of positive density, density at least delta, then you can find lots of copies of whatever subgraph H you're looking for. So it gives you a way of finding many copies of a particular subgraph in a graph. In particular, it allows you, and this is not obvious at all, but it allows you to find three-term arithmetic progressions in sparse sets of integers. So that'll do. It's not obvious how, but I'll do it next week. You can use this to prove Edge of Stone. You can use it to prove all kinds of things. There are lots and lots of things that you can use this to prove that no other method is known. Okay, sorry, we're out of time.